A very pleasant good morning to all the participants who have gathered here for this wonderful national webinar on India Revival Mission, Challenges and Opportunities by Professor Dr. Nana Shekaran, who is an MBA director of Dr. SLS RCAS of in Coimbatore. So before getting into the program, you know, request our beloved principal ma'am, Dr. Manas Kodi, to introduce to welcome the gathering. Please, ma'am.
Yes, okay, sir. Fine.
Ma'am, sorry for this. Your mic is on unmute. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
The speakers of today's session, the learned Professor Dr. Gnana Sekaran, the Director of MBA Program, Dr. SNSC College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore. Dear professors, participants, students, and the person who have all who have joined in our program all over the country, I express my warm welcome. And I also express my warm welcome on behalf of Geeta Jeevan Arts and Science College Management, Secretary, Principal, and the faculty members of Business Administration of our college. I especially thank our chief guest, that means the resource person of today. He is an eminent economist, and who has readily accepted our own invitation within a short period. In spite of his busy schedule, he has given his consent to address in this national seminar on India's revival mission, the opportunities, the challenges and the opportunities. I am very much eager to listen to his lecture, because we are all worrying about the COVID, not only of COVID-19, we are also worrying about our Indian economy also, not only in the house, because it is a heavy loss to the household economy as well as to the, it is a last heavy loss to our Indian economy, and it is a slowdown as far as the economic position is concerned. So we are eagerly waiting for your lecture, sir, because you are going to share your knowledge among all the participants. So that means instead of sparing my own time in this, giving this long lecture, I hand over the session to Mr. Senthil Ganesh, sir, who will introduce our chief guest today. Once again, I express my warm welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Over to Professor Senthil Ganesh to introduce the chief guest. Could you please unmute yourself, sir?
Yeah. Good evening to everyone. I am much overwhelmed to introduce resource person of this national webinar. Dr. Gnana Sekaran holds more than 4 decades of experience. He holds 2 master's degrees, one in economics and other in management. He also holds an MPhil and PhD. He served as an associate professor and head in the postgraduate department of economics of St. Joseph College, Trichy. After his retirement, he took up the position as principal of Dr. SNS Rajalakshmi College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore. After his yeoman service in the capacity of principal, he was assigned with the capacity as a College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore. He has presented more number of papers, research papers, both at national and international levels. He also published more number of articles in leading and renowned journals. He has also guided many scholars. He is a teacher, a guide, a philosopher. More than all of this, he is great economist too. With this great note, I'm happy to introduce him. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Senthil. So before getting into the program, I now request all the participants to kindly stay back till the end. So at the end of the session, the chat box will be kept open for you for question and answer. At the same time, the feedback link will be put up over there on the chat box. So I request the participants to, at the end of the session, to click on the feedback link which was shared over there in the WhatsApp, in the chat box, and leave your feedback, because that will facilitate you to get your e-certificate. And with this couple of instructions, may I now request our beloved resource persons and eminent economist of the state to take over the session. Professor Dr. Gnana Sekaran, Director of the MBA Program of Dr. SNS Rajalakshmi College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore, to take over the session. Please, sir.
Thank you, Diliban, for a wonderful introduction. And also, I'm really happy to interact with you, the galaxy of teachers, eminent professors, scholars, and the authorities of Geeta Jeevan College. I'm really happy that this is a very, very vexing, taxing topic which is assigned to me. I hope I will measure up to your expectations fast. If you take actually the topic for our discussion today is India's revival mission, challenges and opportunities. So the COVID is wrecking unparalleled damages in the Indian economy, as you all know very well, that almost all the sectors of the economy are in jeopardy, and all the sectors are in deterioration. And even before the COVID, what is actually in store for the Indian economy is actually the slump. It's not a temporary slump. If you take before even March 2020, you find the Indian economy is in doldrums. So it is actually a bolt from the blue, because it is a double whammy. Double whammy in the sense, you find already the economy is suffering and it is baffled by so many problems, is affected by a boss virus like COVID. So it is a double whammy in the sense, it's an issue which is related to not an advanced, a vibrant economy. It's an economy in which you find a lot of, 91% of the people are in agriculture and the unorganized sector. Only the organized sector is actually in constitute a minuscule percentage in India. Such a vast unorganized economy, when it is actually reeling under COVID, then it is a big problem, it's a big issue, which is unsurmountable to a large extent. But if you look at the response from the government, it is really encouraging. We cannot actually criticize openly. Whatever the government says, it is the government is doing whatever the best. Because we look at actually, if you look at actually the pillars, the five pillars of the economy, you find as pronounced by our esteemed Prime Minister of India, there are five pillars of the Indian economy. The first one is look at the economy as a whole, as a macroeconomic view. So it is not microscopic view, it is a macroscopic view. All the Indians, be Indian, buy Indian, that's a concept. Economy should be improved. And the economy which is actually aiming to become the second or third the largest economy in the whole world, because we are now in the rank of fifth industrially developed economy. When we want to become actually the third or fourth in the affluent economy in the world. So for example, national income, or I can say in the crude way, GDP is now around $2.75 trillion. And if we hope that we are going to reach that level of nearly $7 trillion in the year 2047. And in the year 2047, according to our Prime Minister, India will be the second or third largest economy in the whole world. And if you look at the second important pillar, the infrastructure is the state of art in Indian economy. Infrastructure is an important nerve center of Indian economy. If you are able to have an infrastructure of par excellence, then there is always a flow of FDI. And the FDI is going to flow if you are able to improve the infrastructure. Another important dimension of this is the COVID. Because of the COVID, there is a lot of bad blood flowing between the countries and China. And China is now the acquisitions which are actually carried out against China. And most of the firms and industries which are now actually doing business in China may be shifted to India. India, if you are able to provide a world-class infrastructure, the firms which are deserting China will come to India and they will have a safe haven in India. They will do business in India. Then the system, you know very well that it is a system in which you are living, is actually a vibrant system in which there is no what is called the policy paralysis. When there is no policy paralysis, when the system is really vibrant, it is taking the decision very expediently, and you are able to get all the things which are, for example, if you take the development of the industries and maybe taken very few months in India, if the system is really vibrant, and there is a single window system in India now, it is just catering to the needs of the starting up of industries. Then democracy, you know very well that it is also very important in the sense that the democracy, India is one of the biggest democracies in the world, next to, I can say, on par with the United States of America. And if you take 137 crores of population in India, the democracy is, the shift of power is very, 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 very smooth and self-propelling in India. There is no set of what is called blood as far as democracy is concerned. And this is very important for the development of the country, because if you take democracy, there is a freedom. There is a perfect freedom in democracy. This is a major, I can say, economic advantage of India. being a democratic country in the world, there is a freedom to exist, a freedom to choose occupation, freedom to enter into the industry, freedom to leave the industry. So all these are very, very important points with regard to the democracy. The last important pillar, as mentioned by the esteemed Prime Minister of the country, is the demand. The demand is not at all coming in India. Let me give a very simple example to you. If you take the last Pongal celebrations, you find that usually in Coimbatore, one pair of sugar cane cost nearly 80 rupees. Now today, the last Pongal, you can get the same pair of karumbu, the sugar cane, for just 30 rupees, because there is no demand, there is no rural income. So all these are all very important points with regard to India Revival Mission. So if you look at the broader scenario, as I mentioned, there is already a problem with the Indian economy, and we want to become a global leader. So if you want to become a global leader, you must have what is called the industrial development. The first one is industrial development. The industrial development, once again, in India depends upon the agricultural development. If you want to become a global leader, and a disputed global leader, you must have what is again the leadership. The leadership, you take the world global forums like IMF and International Monetary Fund. If you take IBRD, International Bank for Reconstruction Development, World Bank, if you take a UN or United Nations organization, India's position is unenviable because we are the founder member of almost all the world bodies. Then if you take the second important broader scenarios, and there is a vocal for local. So the vocal for local means, if you take actually this, not actually protectionism policy, we are living in the area of actually free trade and fair trade. But vocal is also important, because the vocal is actually giving the support for the local industries. Whatever possible in the form of import, and it is possible in the form of import substitution and export promotion. It is an outward-looking policy. So what our esteemed Prime Minister is telling is an outward-looking policy. The outward-looking policy is very important, because the next corollary is the self-sustenance. The self-sustenance is an important goal of the Indian economy. The self-sustenance means standing on your own legs. You are not depending upon the other countries, because one of the very important characteristic feature of Indian economy is foreign trade orientation. We are depending upon foreign trade. So if you're depending on the foreign trade, what is vulnerable in the foreign countries? For example, if you take the global financial crisis in the 90s, the global financial crisis in the 90s actually damaged the Indian economy, because we are depending upon the foreign countries for our imports. Fourth important broader scenario is the liquidity. The liquidity means the easy availability of money, because liquidity in the sense money is available in cash. If the money is available in cash, then people will consume, there will be demand, there is a demand, because as Keynesian concept, you know, there is an effective demand. If the effective demand is, you know very well that the effective demand leads to employment. So the unemployed resources in India, not only I'm not talking about unemployed human beings, I'm talking about unemployed resources, minerals, materials, water resources. All the resources will be able to find the self-expression if there is a large amount of liquidity in the economy. Then, the fifth important one is the development into mass movement. Development means not actually unidimensional, it is multidimensional. It is actually percolates into all sections of the society. India being the greatest democracy, development is not lying in the ivory towers. Development is actually going to the remote corners of the village. Development is sporadic. It is all inclusive. What actually development into mass movement means, it is inclusive development. Inclusive development is development from the below. Development means the participation of rural masses. So I want to say that this concept is very important, that development into mass movement, because we find the development is actually honored by few vested interested, and the crony capitalists are actually taking the sway as far as the Indian economy is concerned. Then if you look at the largest economy in the world, it is the present largest economy in the maybe United States of America, closely followed by I can say China. But we are able to challenge them in the years to come, and we hope that if the same rate continues. Let us not discuss about the rates which are GDP rates which are followed in the COVID period, but we are going to bounce back. It is going to cause only a wrinkle. So what I want to say is that COVID is going to cause only a wrinkle. It is not going to cause a deep scar. So what I say is, it is only a temporary slump in the Indian economy. Indian economy will bounce back, it will grow leaps and bounds in the years to come. Then let me pass on to the most important aspect of how you are going to revive the Indian economy. If you revive the Indian economy, the revival is actually taking the form of a very big stimulus package as conceived by our esteemed Prime Minister. If you take the total stimulus package of 20.97 lakh crore, as students of management and economics, you know very well that the stimulus package is coming from the two spectrums. So one spectrum is actually from the RBI, Reserve Bank of India, or Apex Bank. The another one is coming from the Finance Minister of India, you know, Nirmala Sitharaman. So if you take actually the RBI measures and the measures taken by the Finance Ministry, it is totaling amount to 20.97 lakh crore. It is approximately the 10% of the GDP, because our GDP is around 200 lakh crore and our total stimulus package is 20.97 lakh crore. It is coming around nearly 10% of the total package. But if you look at the actually the package given by the RBI measures by providing liquidity, and it is a tune of 8.01 lakh crores. And this, if you are combining with the measures taken by the Finance Ministry and the RBI measures, in total it comes about 20.97 lakh crores. So you have to add the RBI measures also to the tune of 8.01 lakh crore to the package of 20.97 lakh crores. Then let me pass on to the constituents of the stimulus package. The one thing which is very, very pertinent to you is whether these measures are actually transferring the income from the government to the needy poor, deserving poor. That's a question you have to ask. Because this is these measures are primarily is giving credit. Let me openly admit that. And if you look at the total package, nearly only 1 lakh crore out of 20.97 lakh crore, only 1 lakh crore is given in the form of cash payment, which is direct cash transfer. And it will boost the income and it will boost the purchasing power, it will boost the demand, it will boost the investment and everything. It will lead to multiplier effects. But if you look at the nearly 90%, more than 90% of the measures, these measures are coming from the banks, the form of credit. Okay, so let me explain what is actually the different constituents of the stimulus package. The first one is free food grant to the tune of rupees 1.92 lakh crores. You know very well that as students of management, you know, as students of economics also, you know, but there is a India is having universal public distribution system. So this India is one of the biggest public distribution system in the world, and all the affordable commodities, the essential commodities are supplied at an affordable price. So if you are having this type of things, almost you find the poverty is banished in India. It is because of the free food grants given through PDS, Public Distribution Center. So the government is allocating nearly 1.2 lakh crores because the food is the basic essential thing. If the whole world is actually affected by what is called the COVID, and it is ravaged by famines, and you find there is a need for giving protection, shelter, and in the form of what is called hand-holding, I can say. The hand-holding is given in the form of free food grants to the tune of 1.92 lakh crores. Then the next important sector, which is in doldrums, which is mostly affected, is MSME sector, because this is a sector which is giving lots of employment, because you know very well that 91% of the rural poor is actually in the organized sector, in the unorganized sector. MSMEs are actually providing lot of employment. It is a labor intensive sector. It is not a capital intensive sector. It's a labor intensive sector. This sector should be revived, because this sector is already under the clutches, because they are suffering from two important blows. One is relatively a very important blow, demonetization, and another important one is the GST. You know very well that if these two are not coming, I'm not saying that these are the two flagship programs of the government, but these two flagship programs of the government adversely affected the MSME sector. They are reeling under a severe burden already, but if the government is knowing very well that this MSME sector is adversely affected by because of the lockdown, because of, you know, very well the lockdown 1, 2, 3, 4. Because of the lockdown, you find the MSME sector is the worst hit sector because there is no transport of labor, there is no logistics of raw materials. So the government is really interested in pumping the money to the MSME sector to the tune of ₹5.94 lakh crores. The MSME sector will actually get the credit from the banks. So once again, I repeat, it is the credit from the banks, and the credit guarantee is given to the given by the government to provide loan. And even today, you find our esteemed Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, Mr. Palanchami, Edappadi Palanchami, he actually wanted the commercial bank to give a big way to three sectors. One is, he is saying that self-help groups of women, the self-help groups of women should be given top priority. The second stage is the MSMEs. Third important thing is agriculture, the priority sector. All the three sectors must be very important, which are giving actually the what is called the crop loans. So the annual credit plan is actually released by our esteemed Chief Minister yesterday, and this is actually catering to the needs of the three important sections of the society. Then the migrants, this is a very big issue. You know very well that it's a big issue. Still people are saying that migrants are migrating. So now it's a high time that you have to find out what is called the social mapping of migrants, where the migrants are actually residing, how to give the protection to the migrants. Then there is a COVID like this situation, yeah, exigency. You find the migrants are the worst affected. You find a lot of people on the way to their destination, on the way to their natives, faced with the self-extinctions. You find maybe met with some accidents, maybe met with some problems, and they are still, it's a big issue. Now, the state governments are actually, the way, even the court, the judiciary advocated that it's a duty of the state government to protect the migrants. And the central government is giving a, what is called the food, and the food is a basic essential, the tune of 3.10 lakh crore. But the shelter is also important. The employment is also important. These are the other spectrums we are not discussing now. Then the third important thing is the agriculture infrastructure. Agriculture is actually the most vulnerable sector in India. Even though agriculture is our culture, people say, agriculture is not doing well. If you look at the past decadal growth of agriculture, it is hovering around 2%. And some of the years you find agriculture is recording the negative growth rate. So there is the need for spending more money on agriculture. Agriculture is receiving to the tune of 1.50 lakh crores. Once again, I want to remind that it is not the amount which is transferred into the agriculture or invested in agriculture. It is the amount which is going to be given to the agriculture in the form of crop loans. Then the last one, you find the fourth and fifth tranches, the structural reforms. Structural reforms are really, really controversial, and we are going to discuss the structural reforms later. The most important structural reforms I can say is privatization. So if you look at the sectors which are reserved in the 1948 industrial policy, the sole sectors, because the sectors are having what is called the commanding heights of the economy, there's mines, atomic energy, space energy, and almost all important precious resources which are hitherto reserved for the public sector is going to be given to the private sector. And we will discuss the structural reforms, because the structural, I think it's the more interesting and it's the most fascinating aspect of our discussion today. Then who are the major beneficiaries? The first one is the people in large. We find India is a one nation, you know. You find it's a one nation, one ration card is a situation now, you find. So you find, look into the situation of the migrants. Migrants are constituting nearly, in India, according to rough estimates, 5 crores. So if you look at the Indian economy, the recent estimate is 137 crores. Of the 137 crores, nearly 2% of, 2.5% of the people are migrants. If 2.5% of the people are migrants, then there is a need for protecting them. Then that's why the government rolled out a program called One Nation, One Ration Card. One Ration, One Ration Card, there is a prevention that if One Nation, One Ration Card will be there, what will happen to the already ration holders in the particular locality? But you know very well that this is a PDS is actually hovering around what is called actually the central government missionary. Whatever you are getting from the public distribution system, we are getting from the public central divisible pool. Public divisible pool is giving the public distribution system items. the items which are necessary for the distribution. So one nation card is, I think it is not going to affect the people who are already receiving the localities. And it is maybe the migrants may be going to receive the ration and they are going to settle down, because you know very well that now this is a situation that without migrants, no activity will be taken by the locals. No activities. No, you take any field, any part of Tamil Nadu, you'll find most of the activities are undertaken, most of the nebulous labor-saving activities are undertaken only by, I can say, not the labor-intensive activities are taken by only by the migrants. Then, the another important thing is the credit card, Kisan credit card, to the tune of 2 lakh crores. Those who are giving the credit card, Kisan credit card, they are going to receive 2 lakh credit because the rabi crops is cultivated already. And the, when the rabi crops is cultivated really well, and there is a need for getting the money for the transportation and the storage, because you know very well that the rough estimate says really 20% of the produce in agriculture is wasted because of the pest, and because wasted because of the transmission, and because of the and third important thing is the quality of the products is deteriorating consistently because of the poor storage system. And the 2 lakh crore is meant for providing warehouses and for grading and standardization of agricultural produce which are produced by the farmers. Then the third important thing is this is the Essential Commodity Act is deregulated, because you know very well that there is a common complaint against the government that the agriculturists, even though they are producing a lot of commodities, they are not having any say in the fixation of price. You take industrial commodities, they are all produced by the industrialists and corporates. They are fixing the price. But if you look at the agricultural commodities, the most essential commodities, the essential commodities are produced by the backbone of the Indian economy, agriculturists, but they are not having the freedom to fix a price. But if you look at this deregulated Essential Commodities Act, this Essential Commodities Act actually provides an elbow room for the agriculturists to fix the price for they are producing. If they are producing the commodities, they are having every right to produce the commodities. At the same time, they are able to produce essential commodities, not only essential commodities, but also commercial commodities like you take the oil producing commodities, pulses and all, the gingerly and all, you find the essential commodities they are able to produce with the help of the deregulated ESMA, you can say. Then the next one is MSME, and I told you already MSME is a sector which is providing large scale employment, and the MSME sector is, I told you, it is because of the two government policies very much affected. This 3 lakh crore will provide a cushion for the MSMEs to start their industry. Because the MSMEs, you know very well that they are having an advantage because they are having the local labor, they are having the local capital, they are having the local infrastructure, they are having the very simple technology, and above all, it is labor intensive, and they are contributing a more than 51% of what is called the GDP to the nation. So there is every, I think, every support for giving rupees 3 lakh crore to MSMEs. Then the capital infusion for MSMEs, once again, it is to the tune of 50,000 crores. But you may ask a question, sir, already the commercial banks are actually coming under the problem of capital infusion. Already commercial banks are in red. Most of the commercial banks are actually is going on in India. It's a tricky, skewed condition. Whether it is possible for the if the Reserve Bank of India and if the government of India is actually giving the support, unconditional support, it's a collateral support, guarantees, there is every possibility there is a capital infusion to the tune of 50,000 crores to the MSMEs. Micro flood, I told you, the food cluster is because most of the farmers are disintegrated. There is no actually farming community as such. And there is a micro food cluster because it's based on a cooperation principle. The cluster is based on cooperation principle. All for each for all. All for each for all. This micro food cluster will be created to the tune of nearly 10,000 crores. And another important thing is that NABARD, you find it's an agriculture wing of the Reserve Bank of India. NABARD is nothing but National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. And this is an being of the Reserve Bank of India. This Reserve Bank of India is actually giving to the agriculturists once again to the tune of nearly 30,000 crores. But I repeat, I want to remind you that it is only a credit. Then similarly, loans to state vendors to the tune of 5,000 crores. This is a very important, I can say, a path-breaking contribution, I can say, from the government, because so far, commercial banks and cooperative society banks, they are not actually giving loans to the street vendors. Now, giving the industrialist they are giving credit to what is sections of the society, and the street vendors are able to get now 5,000 rupees. So out of 5,000 crores, yes, street vendor is able to get 5,000 rupees. This means the street vendors are actually coming out of the what is the draconian clutches of the local money lenders, who are charging exorbitant rate of interest, and they are fleecing the blood of the actually the street vendors. The street vendors are now able to approach the commercial bank, and they are able to get nearly 5,000 rupees, and they are not going to pay what is called the very, very, very high interest rate, exorbitant interest rate. They are going to pay a moderate interest to the tune of nearly 10-12%. And this will be, a very important path-breaking stimulus package of our Prime Minister Modi. Then agriculture storage, I already mentioned that the agriculture storage is very important, because 20% of the produce is wasted because of the pests. This is this sector, this particular item receives rupees 10,000 crores. Then let me pass on to the most controversial aspects, structural reforms. So the structural reforms, EPF contribution of 12-10%, it is a marginal reduction. So what actually it means, it is actually increasing 45,000 crores approximately to the corporates. If the contribution by the corporates to the government is reduced by 2%, because it is a contribution by the corporates to the government for the employees, if it is reduced, then automatically you find they are having what is called an excess fund, a surplus. That surplus may be used for playing back and for improving the business. So it is a cash starved economy where liquidity is not possible, where the money is not coming. This EPS contribution of reduction of 12% to 10% is providing a big relief for the corporates to venture upon other industries, even for expansion. Similarly, TDS and TCS reduction of 25%. This is actually not a relief. Strictly speaking, it is not a relief. So because it is actually a relief of the reduction of 25% means you are going to actually pay the later dates. Now you for 3 months this reduction is given up to the tune of 25%, but you have to pay in the later month. It is actually a temporary transitory time being relief. It is not a permanent relief. Then another important, very, very interesting, I may say a burning, a vexing issue is called mineral defense, airspace and atomic energy privatization. So as I mentioned at the time of my introductory speech, coal, mineral, defense, airspace, and atomic energy, these are the vital sectors which is very important, because they are some of the sectors like airspace and atomic energy are strategically important. So the defense of the nation is depending upon atomic energy and airspace, and they are actually going to relax this, and they are going to give to the private sector. This is the stimulus package, which is actually a big boon for the private sector. But there are apprehensions. There are apprehensions. Maybe they are not unfounded. I'm not criticizing. They are not unfounded. But this is the unbridled privatization. Sometimes people say that privatization leads to pauperization. So privatization may lead to pauperization. But these sectors are in the 1948 policies because they are called the commanding heights of the economy. These sectors would be exclusively controlled by the government. It should not be given to the private sector. But this government, I can say that our government is giving what is called the red carpeted welcome without red carpet. Red carpeted welcome to corporates in order to boost the coal and mineral, because the coal and mineral, people say we are sitting on the mineral, but we're importing the mineral. So this is a popular slogan. We are sitting on the mineral, but importing the mineral. So coal and mineral are given to the private sector because of the simple reason, the government believes that private sector is very efficient. Private sector is efficient. Another important sector is the private sector is incurring losses. It is not loss for the government. You may ask the question, is it not washing off the hands, sir? It is washing off the hands in a way, but privatization is an important, indispensable, I can say, agenda of the government. So there are apprehensions. These apprehensions, as I mentioned, is not unfounded. There are genuine apprehensions. Similarly, the dilution of labor loss. Now, after the COVID, you find you have to work longer and harder. And there are a lot of the retrenchment, you say, even Infosys, well-established companies. And you take most of the IT measures, most of the what is called the big manufacturing industries. There, you take automobile industries. There is no zero sales in Maruti, the market leader. You take market leader. There's zero sales in market leader. Similarly, there are a lot of industries which are suffering, and there is that's why the government is coming to the rescue of the corporates by diluting the labor loss. Very simple. They can retrench the worker. They can lay off the worker. They can reduce the wages. They can freeze the wages. They can ban the increment. They may not go for fresh appointments. And finally, there is every possibility that every week there may be 6 days work. Hereafter, the labor law says what is called the state governments are given the free hand to amend the labor laws. If the state governments are amending the laws, ILO is questioned, International Labor Organization questioned. But the state governments are going in, you take Uttar Pradesh government, they diluted the labor laws. Even Rajasthan government, which is ruled by Congress, also diluted the labor laws. Now the workers are asked not for 8 hours, 10 hours per day. So dilution of labor laws, freezing of wages, all these are all maybe anti-labor, but this is part of the stimulus package. Then defense production. So so far, as I mentioned, the defense is exclusively under the domain of the central government. But you find now it is open. We are opening the corridors of defense production to the private sector, because one important argument for defense production is, you know very well, India is one of the biggest importer of defense equipment. You know very well that 17% of our GDP is earmarked for defense procurements, defense spending, and you know, interest obligations. These are the two important components. So we are spending a lot of money. What I want to say is we are spending a lot of money on defense imports. So instead of importing the defense items, let us invite the foreign direct investment, foreign institutional investment to start the defense industries in India, so that they are starting the industries here and we are able to produce the commodities with a stringent condition that the commodities exclusively meant for the domestic, and the superfluous and the surplus may be exported to other countries, because otherwise they will not come. The foreign direct investment, foreign institutional investment will not come to India. If you are giving stringent rules, then it is the defense production, the ratio of manager, the proportion, the ownership, it is increased from 45% to 75%. That means 49% itself is a big thing. 49% means you are given only 49% means 51% is the government with the public. So the government has to say now, it is from 45% to 74% to foreign direct investment means 74% means a major chunk of the control. I can say the entire control of the defense production may fall in under the reins of the foreign domestic investors. Okay. Then if you take the airports, then you know, find the airports, you know, Trichy Airport is also going to be privatized soon. That is in the agenda. So most of the airports hereafter are going to be public private participation board, PPP board. What is this? Then you are operating, managing, and then going to transfer. This is the matter. You are going to operate, manage, and then you are going to transfer. This is the PPP board. But if you look at that, the PPP board, actually what is going on in India is, you may have our own doubts. You take our own toll gates. The toll gates are actually under the PPP board. The most important thing is PPP board. so far the PPP board is actually it is really actually anti people, really anti people, because even after the gestation period and all, after actually the return on investment is recovered, I'm talking about return of investment on Dolvis. Even after the return on investment is recovered by the PPP people, and they are still charging. Have you seen that any transparent policy with regard to the what is called PPP mode? So this is also a bone of contention, I guess. It's a bone of contention. Then technology development come incubation. So incubation center, almost all colleges are having incubation center because they want to develop entrepreneurship. Innovation becomes the essence of life. The technology development is very important. And we are living in the era of 4.0, industry 4.0, leadership 4.0. And if we want to develop the digital revolution, the people say, digital learning is going on now. If you are able to technologically develop, and then it's a big problem. So technological development is very important. It hinges on incubation centers. The nerve center, I can say, the cradle for innovation. So this is actually the policy followed from Israel. So Israel is a small country, you find. So Israel is able to produce a lot of innovative products. If you look at the number of Nobel laureates in the world, most of them are from Israel, Jews. The reason is very simple. Even from the childhood, the DNA is innovation. So the innovation is very important. So this incubation center in the college level, incubation center in the school level, provide a much fillip to the young people who are having creativity, not for old people, for young students, like maybe students of schools and colleges. They will have what is called the creativity and inquisitiveness. And because of the incubation center, they may be able to produce a product which are par excellence. And they may be is able to patent. And the colleges are conducting the boot camps. And because of the creation, there is a possibility of prototype products. The prototype products may be producers' products, and they may be exported. India will become a vibrant economy if it is the creativity and innovations are coming from the student community. Then the last one is the IBC reforms. This is a structural policy. So this is the bankruptcy code. Indian bankruptcy code, you find previously, if a corporate, this is also debatable. This is also debatable. In the sense that if a company is under the verge of bankruptcy, and if it is giving what is called the bankruptcy notice, and you can initiate the legal proceeding if it is even for 1 lakh rupees. So this is a policy now. If a company is defaulting 1 lakh crores, you can sue in the court of law, and they are compelled to pay compensation. But now, instead of 1 lakh, you find it is 1 crore. So suppose if you are having 50 lakhs of rupees as default, you cannot go to the court. So the tribunals, the courts, they are burdened with it. The reason is not convincing. The reasons are not giving convincing by the government, because you find there are a lot of cases pending. Just because a lot of cases pending in the courts and tribunals, we are actually shifting the new public sector policy, the IBC reforms, from 1 lakh to 1 crore is ridiculous. In a way, it is ridiculous because it's the duty of the judiciary looking to the common man. Suppose even the tragedy, if even the default is 75 lakhs of rupees, you cannot go to the court of law now. That's a big burden for the common man. Then E-Vidya is a scheme which is launched for the schools from standard 1 to 12. So in the schools, you find there is a smart class, and the smart classrooms are having all equipped facilities, even the schools, all the schools, even the rural areas. This is called E-Vidya. So the rural schools, now the urban schools are having the smart classes, no problem. They are having smart boards and everything. But if you look at the rural schools, they are ill-equipped. The rural schools are giving a very big advantage because of the E-Vidya. And there are classes from 1 to 12. Each and every class having one smart classroom, fully equipped, so that they are able to have what is called, which is now in the hands of urban people, maybe given open to the rural areas. You find more and more rural people will come to the digital learning, and the digital learning will become a way of life. Then the last one is a new public sector policy. New public sector policy, as I mentioned, is a policy which is related to the privatization. New public sector policy is privatization. I don't think there is only one sector, public sector, in a public domain. This is very clear. There is only one public sector in one particular domain. Maybe, for example, coal. Coal Corporation of India, maybe, for example. This may be the one sector. There are no other sectors from the government side. All other sectors will be occupied only by the private sector. So, private sector is given, I can say, uncontrolled freedom as far as the new public sector policy is the concern. Then, additional revenue to the states. You find how the additional revenue is given to the states. So, the borrowing limit of the, what is called the states. So, the states are also borrowing. They are borrowing large amount. You take Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is borrowing large amount of money from so various sources, even borrowing from the government, borrowing from the international organizations, borrowing from the World Bank, and all these things. If Asian Development, for example, it is borrowing, it is a government, a lot of money to the Tamil Nadu government. If it is actually borrowing, then the borrowing limit is increased to 5% now. Well, initially it was only 3%. Now it is given to 5%. That means it itself is having what is called an additional resource of more than 50 crores, nearly 50 crores to the states. I'm talking about India as a whole. More than 50,000 crores, 50,000 crores will be in the hands of the states to undertake what is called the COVID-related measures. But I can say, to conclude, I can say it is going to be an economy with a new normal. The new normal means that the normalcy with which we are living is going to be completely changed. We are now living in a COVID situation. We are, you know very well that we are maintaining social distance, individual distance, I can say, not social distance. Social distance is bad. Individual distance, we are washing our hands, we are using gloves, and we are using masks and everything. We are using sanitizers, and this became a way of life. This became a way of life. And another important thing is, you know, almost all colleges and schools are conducting their educational endeavor only through online. Online became an very important ingredient of our things. Then there is a possibility of migrants. Almost all governments are going to have migrant commissions, and migrants are very important people, and one nation, one ration card going to serve them. And definitely this is also going. Migrant becomes an integral part of India. That's another important thing. Then marketing volatile, you can say, you find even today's newspaper might have seen, there are people affected, even the prison. You know, Pulur's prison in Chennai. Pulur Chennai is a model prison in which you find the prisoners are producing a lot of commodities, handicrafts and other commodities which are related to mass consumption. But these commodities are not able to market because of the COVID. And if you find the COVID situation, marketing is becoming a worldwide problem, and there is a need for what is the cluster marketing. The cluster marketing is going to become a way of life in which all the prisons of Tamil Nadu, they are going to have a cluster, and they are going to market the products at affordable prices. So similarly, you find the minimal. The next thing is the market volatility. Another important information I want to share with you is, so far people always investment, systematic investment plan, equities, mutual funds, share markets, and other important things. Now you look at the condition of India, and the Indian share market has shedding a lot of the Sensex has fallen, the Nifty has fallen, and more than 20 lakh crores. First few days, I'm not giving the exact statistics now. More than 20 lakh crores is lost. It's a lost, you know. The Ambani, one of the richest man, become a very even, I'm talking, and not Anil, I'm talking about Mukesh Ambani, and he lost a lot of money. And he is not actually ranked as high as in the 10th position now. And this is a case of many entrepreneurs in India. They are losing a lot of money because of the market volatility. Let us not worry about the entrepreneurs. Let us take a common investor. The common investor is going to bleed because of the market volatility. And there is a beautiful article in the Hindu today, because what is important is a harmful fixed deposit. This is a new normal. Instead of investing in the risky businesses, better put the money in the fixed deposits, and the fixed deposits are controlled by commercial banks, controlled by government. Then another important, I can say, concluding remark, you initiate the what is called wealth tax. So you find
the actually India is the, if you take the gross GDP tax ratio, I'm talking about gross GDP tax rate, it is very minimal in India. And there is a, already James Tobin pointed out that there is a need for Tobin's tax. Extremely rich, stinkingly rich people. I'm not talking about the middle income group. I'm not taking it higher income group. I'm talking about the people who are actually the captains of the industry. The captains of the industry who are having billionaires actually. And the billionaires, they are not paying any income tax. Not paying the tax. In the way they have to pay, I'm talking about. You take, for example, the corporate tax is actually reduced from 30% now. Even they are not paying 30%, as the 30% is the maximum tax for the salaried people. Let us say that the corporates will pay at least 30% tax. So what is wrong in paying the 30% tax? Similarly, there is a need for wealth tax. Wealth tax is already abolished. And we have to introduce the wealth tax and inheritance tax. Inheritance tax is very important because crores and crores of properties are inherited from one generation to another generation. When it is passing on from one generation to another generation, then the what is called the generation which is receiving, he is going to receive a big bonus. But if it is receiving the bonus, it is not paying any tax. It is an inherited wealth. It is unearned wealth. This unearned wealth is inherited. There is every justification for maybe there are a lot of controversies. I'm not talking about wealth tax, whether it is administered, as I'm not talking about. There is an idea to initiate the wealth tax and inheritance tax. Another important thing is there is a need for creating a secular fund. This secular fund must be initiated because you take actually the contribution from the corporates. Even though the contribution from the corporates are pouring in India, but it is not up to the mark. It is not up to the mark. Indians are not generous. Indian corporates are not generous. If your Indian corporates are not generous, it is the duty of the government to tax the rich and pay for the poor. It is a Robin Hood principle, simple Robin Hood principle. So you see, initiate wealth tax, create a secularity fund, and then make a trade-off, because you know very well, and this is a very important issue, because the trade-off is very important, because whether you are going to save the lives of the people or livelihood of the people. The lives of the people are affected by COVID. The livelihood of the people are affected by the lockdown. So you have to make a trade-off. So if you look actually the Oxford University press release in their press release with regard to researchers conducted on lockdown, there are 8 dimensions. Mr. Kaushik Basu also pointed out that, a noted economist. There are 8 dimensions in the curfew, in the lockdown. But unfortunately, India has not followed the various dimensions. And the total unidimensional lockdown is really dangerous. And it actually created a fear psychosis in the minds of the people. So there is a need for removing the fear psychosis in the minds of the people by providing livelihood. So life is important. And you have to protect the people from coronavirus. And another important thing, you have to provide the livelihood also for the people. So how to provide high livelihood? The livelihood can be given by, I told you, universal basic income. The universal basic income, which is not a very novel idea, new idea. This universal basic income is a transfer of income to the tune of 7,550 rupees to the vulnerable sections of the society. Nearly actually 10 crore people are the most vulnerable sections of the society, according to Raghuram Rajan. When 10 lakh people are given nearly 7,000 rupees and that, it comes about nearly 75,000 crores. 75,000 crores is a pittance as far as our budget is concerned. If you are able to give universal basic income, transfer of income from the government, direct transfer of income from the government to the needy people, definitely the purchasing power will improve. Definitely they will relief from the fear psychosis. There is a security, stability, and the economy will march vibrantly because of this issue of universal basic income. With this, I can say, both of you, I can say I'm not going to the intricacies of the COVID, but I'm really thankful for the college, Idachavan College, the principal, esteemed principal of the college, and the coordinator for giving a wonderful opportunity. Let me thank the participants who actually, in large number, I can say, and the large numbers, and I really appreciate you for your participation. And I have to give you a big support and big hand for the organizer. And it is because of his efforts this seminar is able to find the light of the day. And let me once again request you to stay with us. And if you are having some apprehensions, doubts, queries, questions, and whatever your ideas, and it is not gospel. Whatever I speak is not a gospel of truth. Whatever I speak, maybe you may be free to disagree with me. You are free to disagree with me. So let me throw the ball into your court so that you can also process, you can also share your ideas. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Ladies.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you for the wonderful insights, economical insights, which is actually in need of the hour. I thank Professor Dr. Nana Shekharan, sir, who has readily accepted and made this program knowledge-oriented session. And there are a couple of questions is there, sir. One question is it the right time for the startup? As an economist, what is your opinion towards it?
I think a startup is, there is no proper time to start up an industry. I can say even if you find, if there is what is called the uncertainties, there are, if the situation is risky, the situation is troublesome, you can start up the startup. Startups are almost the parcel of life. You can always go for the startups because startups, maybe if you take the real definition of the startup, if you look at the real definition of the startup, startup is not the industry which is started on the lines of the already existing industries. Let me briefly define what is startup. Startup is an industry which is entirely new, entirely novel, entirely distinct. And if you entirely distinct, if entirely a different service or a different product is cut above the rest, which is actually having the cost advantage, cost effectiveness, look at these conditions. And if you look at these conditions, if it is catering to the needs of the people, and if it is a market success, conduct pilot studies, pilot testing should be made. If the startup is able to serve the competition of big companies, then the startup, you can start. But you have to do a lot of spade work and the pilot studies before starting the startup. It is an opportunity. I'm not saying that this is not a time to start up startups. I'm not pessimistic. You can start the startup.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, most of the MSMEs are using the migrant laborers, the migrant workers. Yes, yes. So is there a possibility of a boom of MSME without a migrant laborers?
My question is very, I have to give you a dismal answer, sir, because I'm a very patriotic Tamilan. I'm a patriotic Indian, but our most of the MSMEs, you take any construction or any industry, now depending upon the migrant labor. And workers from, especially you take Tamil Nadu situation, a case study, most of the laborers are construction laborers, industrial workers, even hotels, in informal laborers. You find in it is ranging in Kanyakumari to Coimbatore, you find laborers are working, migrant laborers are working. So if MSME is, if we are able to pay, there is the problem is even in agriculture, there is scarcity of labor. So how they can, if the agriculture is facing scarcity of labor, how MSMEs are able to tap the local labor? That's a big question. So our MSMEs, I think without migrant labor, it is next to impossible. It's not possible. To me, without migrant labor, MSMEs cannot be finding their proposals, even proposals. It's tough. It's really tough. That's my answer, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Is there any other question? Okay.
What will be the fate of MSMEs, which are mostly labor-oriented in the coming years?
Please repeat the question, sir. Please.
What will be the fate of MSMEs, which are mostly labor-oriented in the coming years?
Labor-oriented in the coming years. Okay. Yes. Labor-intensive sectors, you are asking. Yeah, yes. Very good. So if you take most of the MSMEs, they are all labor-intensive. So one of the biggest advantage of MSMEs, they are all very relatively small. Small is beautiful always. Small is smart. Small is beautiful. Small industries. And they are having the local capital. Their capital is not very, very voluminous. It is not, you are having not a mammoth capital. You are having a small capital. You are having a very simple technology. You are making use of the labor. and you are making use of the raw materials here. Sometimes you are importing. Very sophisticated industries are importing the raw materials also. Mostly you find the income generated here is going to be circulated within India. It is not, of course, there may be an imported component which is going in the form of foreign exchange. But otherwise, the MSMEs are going to stay back, and the labor-intensive industries are going to be, because as Mahatma Gandhi, our father of nation, rightly pointed out, it is production by masses, not mass production. So Gandhian word is Gandhian ideologies are still relevant, and Gandhian ideology is still relevant. It is not mass production. So medium scale industries, small scale industries are very important. Labor intensive industries are very important because they are giving employment. They are giving livelihood. Job is life. If you ask me what is job, what is life? But small scale industries, I can say they have to continue in the long term, and they have to provide a lot of, that's why the government is giving a lot of support and credit support to the MSMEs. So MSMEs are very important, and the MSMEs should, labor intensive sector should be very, very important in a labor abundant country, because unemployment rate is very high in India now. The unemployment rate is very high in India. MSMEs is the answer. So that's my answer, sir.
Thank you, Professor. And there is one particular council named as TIFAC, Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council, which is again under the purview of DST, Department of Science and Technology, is preparing a white paper on the revival of Indian economy. And they have, like, Punjab government has come up with a new group with the experts like the former Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, as well as Dr. Subba Rao, the former RBI governor. And when Dr. Subba Rao was telling about in the 10th May 2020, he has pointed out one thing, that the recovery after this coronavirus, the recovery of India after this coronavirus in terms of this economy, will be having, we can expect a V-shaped recovery. Could you please explain about the V-shaped recovery, Professor?
V-shaped recovery means you look at the shape of the V. If you look at the shape of the V, you take the first component. There are two components of the V. You take the first component of the V. The first component of the V, you find on the top layer, is you find always the boom or the period of prosperity. The V is based on business cycle only. That on the boom or prosperity, you can find there is a lull in the economic activities. You find it will fall. It is a V is like this. It is falling. Then you find at the bottom, there is a trough like this. In the trough, you find there is pessimism, all around pessimism. There is a recession and all. People are saying maybe replacement. And it is when the contraction takes place, when the falling, the one segment of the V is happening, it is actually cumulative. It is having a multiplier effect. It falls very steeply. Look at the shape of the V curve. It is not like business cycle curve. It is a V curve. It is when the slide starts, it gains momentum. It goes on like this. It touches the rock bottom. The lowest pyramid. And then you find when it is actually gaining momentum, because spurring the activity, you are giving lot of incentives. You are energizing the sector. You are giving actually the pump priming mechanism. So that's Keynesian terminology. I can use the pump priming mechanism, pumping the money in the economy, creating the demand. And then you find the revival starts. Once the revival starts, you find the upward V, the upward segment of the V. You find it gains momentum and reaches once again to the top layer, that is boom. So it is just like a business cycle. V means you find this, the first component is receding in the economic activities, contraction in the economic activities, reaching the lowest level. The reaching the lowest level is not the permanent level. There is a new level, and the new level is initiated by the government, because the private sector will not come, because private sector is shy, according to Keynes. Private sector is shy means private sector vekkapadum. Ye vekkapadudhu nu kettingina adu veliya varadhu. So when the private sector is shy, it is not coming in a large way. It's the duty of the government to pump the money. That's what the government is doing, stimulus packages. It is actually gaining momentum. The activities are geared up and gaining momentum. Once it is gaining momentum, you find it is going in the upward direction like this. So this is actually the basic nature of the V-shaped curve, contraction and the expansionary phase. So it is like a V.
Thank you, Professor. You have nicely explained the V-shaped the economic revival concept. And the last question, the final question is, Because during your session, at the end, we really admired to one particular concept, the life and the livelihood. Okay. Life, it is all with the COVID-19.
Livelihood,
it is all about lockdown. And the question, it goes like this.
Yes, sir.
Whether this lockdown makes India weak or stronger, according to you?
It's a very ticklish question to answer, but it is very, very interesting question. Very good question. So lockdown is very important. Lockdown is essential. I can say without lockdown, you find if it is, let me give a very simple statistics, which is given by the medical experts. If there are 100 people, if two people are actually under COVID infected, then you find if there is no what is called quarantine or social distance or lockdown in a broader sense, these two persons will infect 80 persons. Two persons without social distance, lockdown, will infect 80 persons. If there is a lockdown in the real sense, the two persons will infect only two more persons. Even if there is lockdown, even if there is social distancing, there is a possibility of infection. It may double, 2 to 4, not 80. So lockdown is a waste. A lockdown is a useless exercise. A lockdown is futile. It's a monumental flop. So these terms are very sweeping, which I cannot agree. Lockdown is important. But as I mentioned, the lockdown, there are 8 dimensions mentioned by Gaushikpa. Lockdown should be made in phased manner. You take, for example, Germany. They have not actually curtailed the economic activities, but lockdown is on. All major industries are following the safety norms, health norms given by the medical experts, and they are continuing the business. They have not closed the colleges. They have not closed the institutions. They have not closed the industries. They have not closed the airports. Everything is going on, but it is a controlled lockdown. So controlled lockdown is important. And the control is there without affecting your livelihood. But I can say, without lockdown, there are a lot of people die. I told you, 2%, in fact, 80%. Then there will be total turmoil. So lockdown is important, but controlled lockdown, a scientific method of lockdown, followed in advanced countries, may be followed in India. So that is my answer, sir.
Rightly said, Professor, because all the answers what you have told and your session was highly informative and made us to think very wide, I hope so. In Tamil, but after your session, it gave us a very wide opening in our knowledge, like about the variations, lockdown and controlled lockdowns. But it was very nice, Professor. So, dear participants, we have given the feedback link in the chat box. You can click to it and you can leave your feedback, which will facilitate you to get an E-certificate. And we came to the last session, vote of thanks. And it is my profound duty to thank our beloved management.
One minute, sir. So, I'm extremely thankful to you. I have to thank you, sir, please. Accept my humble thanks because it's an eye-opener for me, because I'm relatively a very conservative teacher. I'm not open to this type of things, but it is because of people like you. You encouraged me to participate. So without any inhibition, without any hesitation, I have to thank you and your principal, madam, and your college authorities. And also my students in the St. Joseph's and other colleges who are watching. And there are a lot of people watching in your college. I with the folded hand, I thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Now it is over.
Thank you, sir. So it's like a profound duty to thank the college management who have permitted us to do this wonderful national webinar on the India Revival Mission, the opportunities and challenges. And it's a hand folded, I would like to thank the senior most professor, the director of MBA program of Dr. SNS Rajalakshmi College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore. I know him personally for about 4 to 5 years, I hope so. But I was very close to him, associated with him for the past 2-3 years. But he was such a man of kind, a man of humbleness again. So I can tell more thing about Professor Nanashekaran sir. So with immediately when I was asking, he has readily accepted the invitation and he has joined us. Because again, as my principal has told earlier, he is a great economist. probably out of this 1 hour of lecture shows him how typically he has come up with all the points. See, people like even we as an Indian citizens, we have not come across with all those technical jargons, with all those concepts that was prevailing in India. But he has touched a lot many things even at this 1 hour, because if you're talking about economics, it is again, it is like an ocean and it becomes boredom when we are in the economics class. But even this 1 hour of time period, he doesn't make us boredom. He has thrown away many things to enlighten us and to think over us, and based on our thinking to act also. So it is from the bottom of my own heart and from the GJAC management, principal, faculty members and students, we thank you from the bottom of our heart, Professor Dr. Nanasekaran sir. Thank you very much, sir. It is my profound attitude to thank Dr. Uma Mageshwari, because she is the one who was a platform for me to get connect with the professor in making this program a grand success. I thank Dr. Uma Mageshwari, who is the research coordinator of Dr. SLS Rajaleshwari College of Arts and Science, for her tireless effort and giving an opportunity for us to get a program with the Professor Dr. Nanasekaran sir. Thank you very much, Uma ma'am. And I would like to thank our beloved principal ma'am, Dr. S. Malarpadi ma'am, who is always there as a guiding support and a motivating factor, only because professors like our own, like a consecutive teacher, how Professor Nanasekaran is, the consecutive teacher, Dr. S. Malarpadi is. She is also a retired professor and head from the Aided Institution, and she was there holding the position of principal in our institution. But even though with all this age, she won't reluctant to tell, she won't reject anything else. Whenever we are approaching her for doing all these things, I don't know how many of the institution principal is attending meeting. They'll come to welcome or they come to felicitate for about 10 minutes and they'll be moving off. But we have a wonderful principal who will be there for all the programs. Amidst it is whatever department it may be, whatever discipline it may be, he will be sitting and watching for all 1 hour. Even it prevails more than 1 hour also, so he'll be sitting and watching. So such a great principal we have in our institution. And I thank Dr. S. Malarpadi ma'am for her wonderful guidance and support. And we hope that this will extend in the further days also, ma'am. I would like to thank my own faculty members who are there again, strong pillars of support. Whatever the program that we organize, amidst again, whatever the discipline it may be, even today by afternoon 2:30 to 3:30, we have one program which is associated with Tamil University Thanjavur, and most of our program who are not even connected with Tamil department have also registered, my own professors, my own college professors. So that is what the spirit I'm seeing in my college professors. I would like to thank from the bottom of heart the professors at our own university. And last but not the least, I want to thank the participants who have enthusiastically overwhelming your participation, have had weightage for this program. And I hope there was a great learning outcomes out of this session, and there are much more takeaways are there out of this session. I hope so think on it. So not after this, let us not go for people. There are few people I'm finding that after the completion of the program, there are few people go on assisting us asking for the e-certificates. Let's not think about the e-certificate. This is the lockdown is the right time for us to learn more things. Again, even everything, as professor has rightly said, the institution has been locked. Many things have been locked. But the learning it is not locked down. And again, it is unblocked, the learning. So we have a great learning today in this session. Take away the best part. Implement it. Think over it. Put your thought into an action, so that you can come up with a research. You can come up with a proposal. You can submit it to the government. You can submit it to the other funding agencies, and you'll be getting. That is what the success of out of attending all these programs, rather than going behind the e-certificates. Of course, e-certificates will be mailed to you very shortly. But before that, it is my profound duty that we are working for IQAC NAC. So most of the participants are, because of the IQAC, they are attending many programs. Not for IQAC, only for the sake of our own knowledge growing. We'll attend many programs, we'll enrich our knowledge, so that the moment after this lockdown gets over, when you're moving to the institution, we'll be not a constructive teacher, as professor said. We'll not be a traditional teacher. We will not be in the way where we have born and brought up. There will be a facelift is there for all the professors in the coming days after this lockdown. And this is what I personally felt. And I am in that particular part. So now most of the people have started calling themselves as a digital coach. Okay. So now professor is turning as a digital coach because of the digital learning platform. So make yourself as a digital coach rather than be a traditional teacher. So let's all work together. Let's all be as a team and get succeed in our life in the coming days. And with this great note, I thank all the participants and every one of you for your support, cooperations, and making this program a grand section. Thank you, one and all. Thank you. And may God bless you. Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Principal.
Thank you. Thanks.